Alive. So let's go to another problem, which is resistance to antibiotics, which is one of the most severe problems in modern medicine. For shedding light on it, we tried first of all to find out how do the pathogen acquire resistance. So one of the most prominent mechanism is to modify the anchor exactly where it binds. Make G instead of A in the genome of the bacteria. Bacteria know to do it. So this is the whole story. You remember the selectivity was based on G instead of A, but it's also the same mechanism, one of the mechanisms, for resistance. Acquires resistance by mutation. The bacteria mutates itself like that and comes out with G, no binding. That's the simplest resistance. And bacteria, they live about 4 hours. This is their new generation, 4 hours, 6 hours, sometimes 1 hour. They can have 4 to 5 generations a day. So they can change and change and change until one survives, and this is G. So can we combat resistance? So I think we should, but I'm not sure we can. Because in my opinion, bacteria want to live. They will find a way to live. You see, bacteria were on the planet before us. They were with the dinosaurs. The dinosaurs are gone. Bacteria are still around. They are with us, and I don't want to talk about the future. I'm not a pessimist, but the pessimists say they will be after us. They want to live. They will find a way. But we can try to find ways to attenuate them, to minimize the resistance or to control it or to look for other things, but I'm now talking only about antibiotics. So let's go back for a minute. Some ways. So one of the ways to make better antibiotics is to modify the existing antibiotics by adding anchors. And the other is to make drugs made of two components. Adding anchors is shown here. This is, you see, below is the erythromycin, and this is azithromycin with one more atom. This is fantastic. And if you want to hear about this antibiotic, which was found to be really very good, it was done in Croatia, in a company called Pliva. And I met the chemist of this company in the 80s, actually in Hong Kong airport. We were waiting for a flight. And he told me about it. And he said that they made it in order that it will bind to resistant strains. It means to strains that have G instead of A. So I told him, oh, what are you doing? It will bind also to the patient. And he said, no, we already tried it. We actually made it for vet, for veterinary, for animals. But my daughter was very ill. For 3 weeks, she could not get rid of her pneumonia. So I already had in the lab a little bit of the powder of this, and I brought it home, and I gave it to her, and she recovered in 3 days. So it works. I wouldn't dare to try on my daughter, but he did, and she recovered. But I was still puzzled, because I thought if it binds to resistance with G, it will bind also to the person. So we made some study on it, and what we found is that azithromycin binds to a model of pathogen across the tunnel. If this is the tunnel direction, this is azithromycin in bacteria. And there was, in the literature, another group did binding of azithromycin to archaea that has already G in this position. And it binds, but it doesn't bind across. It binds on the walls. So it disturbs maybe a little bit the proteins to go out, but it leaves enough space. So it's good that I was wrong, because azithromycin is a very successful antibiotic. It's sold by Pfizer. And what I learned from it, and that's a good lesson for chemists, binding is not synonymous to inhibitory activity. The fact that there is A or G in this position only shows if there is or is no binding, or even not this. But it doesn't show how the binding mode is, what is the efficiency, and if there is clinical usefulness. The other way is synergism, and here I have a better story. Antibiotics that are made of two components, and one of them came into the market about 10 years ago, 12 years ago now, Synerceed. So look at it. Here, these are the tunnel walls. This is one compound, and this is the second of the same Synerceed. Isn't it fantastic? Look at it, win-win. All many anchors. One part is inhibiting the other from going out. Fantastic. So my face really was, I became really happy. And I thought that it's bad, is a good idea, because we can combine the two of them together in order not to be dependent on one comes earlier, second come. And we are chemists, we or somebody else can do it. So apparently somebody else thought about it before me, and many bodies else, and did a lot of chemistry, and all of them failed. I didn't have to fail, but they explained their failure that the combined compound was much too large. And they're right, but they also didn't know something else, which I want to show you. So this is the position where peptide bond is being made in detail. The ribosome is in gray, and here, this is the position for peptide bond. I wanted to tell you that there is a nucleotide, one of the bases of the ribosome, right here, where the bond is being made. And it's very important and very flexible. So let's look at it again. Only the ribosome, before there is bond or anything, this is the nucleotide. Let's look from top. This is the nucleotide. And peptide bond would be made here. Now comes compound one of Synerceed and kicks it out because it is so flexible it can go out. But life is very strong and kicks compound one, and this goes back home. Now there is too much of compound one, so it kicks it out again. And I could show it many times if there was not compound, second compound, that comes and locks everything. Now everything is locked. The nucleotide cannot go back. The first compound cannot go out. This cannot go out. Fantastic. But as I told you, the combination was too large. And also, this antibiotic is too poisonous. So it's not very, very useful. So we, understanding that there is such great chemical potential, we are looking for another pair that may be more less aggressive. And we found in the literature that there is a bacteria in Sri Lanka, Esroshi, which has in its genome, it has a plasmid just to make the two compounds, lancamycin, lancamycin, we call it lanka-lanka. People from Sri Lanka are very happy. And they bind very nicely into the ribosome, and we are now trying to improve it. Just want to show you the difference in size. This is lanka-lanka, and this is Synerceed that I just talked about. Lanka-lanka binds to each other inside the ribosome and also changes the active site. So I think that I will jump all this because before lunch, I had a discussion in Mike's lab, and we discussed an idea. The assumption was, or all the chemistry was, or almost all the chemistry was supporting, that in each ribosome, the stoichiometry of all components is 1-to-1. Doesn't matter where the ribosome comes from, it's 1-to-1. If it's larger, if it's human, it's 4 million, bacteria, 2.5 million, but each component shows up once. And all of them are needed. I didn't say peptide bond formation and decoding are made by RNA, but there are many proteins. And the proteins are, first of all, keeping the RNA in position that they can make the peptide bond. I think I showed it in the slide. But also they are interacting with the cell. So the larger the cell and the more functions of the cell, the larger the ribosome, and the proteins, the additional proteins, are on the periphery. Now, as I said, the idea is or was that all proteins are in the ribosome in a stoichiometry of 1:1, except for one protein that is undergoing post-translational alterations, and it's really almost out of the ribosome, so let's forget it. It's L7 in or L12 in bacteria. Recently, in the last 5, 7, 10 years, there were some evidence that it's not correct, that there can be alterations in the copy number of the R proteins. So first, I want to show you results not from our lab, from a lab in Mexico, that they showed a alteration in copy number by only at the messenger RNA level. It means they measured how much messenger was made. The story is that the Mexican government is interested in having a maize, in reducing the price of maize. This is what they like to support. Maize, when they buy a kilo of maize or something, more or less half of it does not grow. This is a finding. And they found some ways that they can even predict which part will grow and which not. But half of it doesn't grow, it disturbs. So a very interesting study was done in Mexico City, in Uman, by the lab of Stella, and she showed that if she takes first of all, she isolated the growth factor of maize. And she showed that if she grows the non-growing maize on the growth factor, it grows. But growth factor to produce is very expensive. It doesn't help the government to reduce the price of maize. So she decided to look to what it is similar. And the growth factor she found out is similar to insulin. So she used insulin in the garden. And look what happened. Everything grew. All the maize grew. And then she decided to look into what happens to the ribosome. And she found, you can see here, this very complicated table, so I showed them larger. She found that almost all the copy number of messenger RNA in ribosomes changed, either higher or lower. In the small and in the large subunit, only these stayed more or less as they were. We don't know if the proteins were produced, but she had more copies of messenger RNA after insulin, just insulin from a pharmacy. So we decided that we want to look at it more carefully and to see whether we can associate functions to the proteins that changed, regular functions. So we looked at the protein level, not only messenger RNA, but protein. So the first study we made, we used data that was obtained not by us on inflammation. The data were again in the messenger level, but we associated it with the known structures of ribosomes. And you can see acute inflammation. You can see so many changes in messenger RNA in the small subunit and in the large subunit. I don't want to go one by one, just to show you. Here they are, the colored. And all of them are on the surface. And all of them are on places that we know that they have some type of regulation or at least some function. Look, from all sides. I don't want to go one by one, but look at it, the colorful part. I think these are all, no? Yeah. So then we collaborated with a group that is looking at the copy number in the RNA, in the ribosomal protein level. Not only the messenger, but also the actual proteins. And this is breast cancer. And look, the whole idea was to look at proteins, at ribosomes under stress. For instance, in cancer, which I'm showing now, cells are growing faster and larger. And the question that we asked is whether ribosomes have to make proteins. Ribosomes make more proteins because they work harder, or there are more ribosomes. More ribosomes, it's a number, but work harder is changing in their structure that allows to work harder. And look what we found. This is real proteins. Almost none is in the, okay, with the mistake rate or inaccuracy that we can have, maybe all these are called close to the same, to one-to-one. But look at this and look at that. So we are now trying to find out why there are changes and how these changes can be expressed. So actually I can hear a paper written by Isabel Moll last year. Collectively, our results, it means their result, indicate that all cells are equipped with a remarkable toolbox to fine-tune gene expression at the level of translation and emphasize the physiological importance of ribosome heterogeneity for the immediate implementation of environmental information. Just fantastic. She said it, and we are finding it.